So as many of you may have already know, the International Energy Agency was founded more than 40 years ago. Currently, we have 29 member countries with Ireland as our founding members. During the past decades, with the strong support of the IIEA member countries and the hard work of our own staff, IIEA has established itself as one of the most reputable international energy governance bodies. Meanwhile, China is the world's second largest economy, largest energy producer, and carbon emitter. So it's natural for the IIEA to work with China. Indeed, after Dr. Fatih Birol, our current executive director, took office in September last year, he immediately chose China instead of any IIEA member countries as destination of his first international missions as executive director of the agency. During his winning speech in Beijing at the Chinese Academy of Social Science, he talked about the three pillars of IIEA's modernization. First, opening the door of the agency to emerging economies. Secondly, to broaden IIEA's mandate of energy security beyond oil. Third, to make the IIEA the global hub of clean technologies and energy efficiency. And per Dr. Birol's invitation, China's energy minister, Mr. Noor Bakri, led a delegation and attended IIEA ministerial meeting in November last year, during which China became association member of the IIEA together with Indonesia and Thailand. In March 2016, IIEA and the National Energy Administration organized the 20th anniversary ceremony of IIEA-China engagement, during which both sides announced that we have started the process of establishing IIEA-China Energy Cooperation Center in Beijing. If we look at the picture, it is very easy to understand why the IIEA and China should work together. When the IIEA was created in 1974, our members accounted for the majority of global energy consumption and oil imports. However, because of the ascendance of emerging economies, especially China, in global energy arena, IIEA member countries currently only account for less than 40% of global energy consumption. If the composition of the agency remains intact, IIEA's own analysis indicates that our member countries will account for less than 30% of global energy consumption by 2040. In comparison, in several decades, China has surpassed the United States as the world's largest energy consumer. Its share of near one-fourth of global energy consumption is expected to keep the same over the decades to come. Given the rapid ascendance of China in the global energy sector, the international community faces both opportunities and the challenges in engaging China in global energy governance. The fact that IIEA is still not a member of China is not a member of the IIEA is such a good example. If we compare the energy mixture among China, the world average, and the United States, it's easy to discover the energy structure of the United States is very similar as the world average, which means if energy consumption changes in the United States, the implication on world trade is not so significant. In comparison, China currently consumes too much coal, with coal representing near 70% of primary energy consumption in China. no matter what energy forecast we examine, the convergence of energy mixture between China and the world average is inevitable. In other words, the importance of coal in China will decline over time. China will need more and more oil, gas, hydro, nuclear, and renewables in the years to come. Such convergence is expected to have profound implications on global energy and environmental agenda. After the successful concluding of COP21 in Paris in December last year, three countries stand out for their particular contribution. France for its excellent presidency, China and the United States for their willingness to cooperate with each other. In particular, China's intended national determined contribution, INDCs, made very positive impacts on the negotiation process. China committed to peak its carbon emissions around 2030 to reduce emissions intensity by 60 to 65% between 2005 and 2030, to achieve 20% of non-fossil fuel in primary energy mixture by 2030, currently is only 12%, and finally agreed to the 5-year review cycle. Nevertheless, if we compare the BAU scenario with the 2-degree scenario, near 30% of global carbon reduction efforts are expected to be shouldered by China. Since China still considers itself as a developing country, how ambitious China's climate agenda could actually be has become open-ended but also quite important questions. It is not a secret that air pollution has become a serious environmental problem in China in recent years. However, I'd like to remind everyone in this room that air pollution is not a China-only environmental phenomenon. In the past, many IEA countries had a similar policy challenge. I am based in Paris. Air quality could still be quite annoying sometimes during the year. Of course, both the magnitude and scale of air pollution in China is unprecedented. Unlike climate change, for which the responsibilities of taking actions could be easily passed to future generations, air pollution cannot be easily ignored by anyone. In other words, Chinese decision makers who live in Beijing are as eager to resolve this problem as average Chinese. To tackle the challenge of air pollution, it is very important to fully understand sources of PM2.5 emissions. These two figures show that coal combustion so far is the most important source of PM2.5 emissions in China. At the national level, coal accounts for around half of PM2.5 emissions in China. As a result, control air pollution, we need to either to replace coal with cleaner fuels such as natural gas or renewables, or install environmental treatment measurement such as desulfurization, denox, particularly control equipment. In the next slide, I will explain what should be the preferred strategy for China. China's energy governance mechanism imposed a particular challenge for enforcing post-combustion environmental measurement. Currently, energy governance in China is fragmented among many government departments. For instance, while the politically powerful National Energy Administration is the regulator of China's energy sector. Climate change, energy efficiency, energy pricing are the responsibility of the politically more powerful NDRC. While the Ministry of Environment Protection in China is in charge of carbon monoxide emissions, it has nothing to do with carbon dioxide emissions. Not surprisingly, enforcement of energy and environmental regulation has long been the weakest link of China's energy governance. China recently issued the outline of the 13th five-year plan and proposed a first ever absolute national energy consumption cap at 5 billion tons of coal equivalent by 2020. It will be quite interesting to observe how such type of national target could be implemented at provincial level in the future. Recently, peaking of Chinese coal consumption has become international headlines. So I would like to provide my own observations about this very important topic. The Chinese economy was first opened to the outside world in 1978. In 1980 and 1981, Chinese coal consumption declined slightly 2 years in a row. Since then, China's economic boom was largely fueled by coal consumption. After China joined the WTO in 2001, Chinese coal consumption grew rapidly and entered the so-called golden age of coal development in China. However, after the recent Chinese economic slowdown, China's coal consumption peaked in 2013 and then declined 2 years in a row in 2014 and 2015. Then everyone in the energy and climate circle becomes very curious about where Chinese coal consumption has indeed peaked in 2013. To make my presentation a more neutral one, I didn't cite any IIEA publications in this slide. Instead, according to China Energy Research Society's recent forecast, Chinese coal consumption might have already peaked in 2013. I'd like to bring two issues to everyone's attention. First, such a research finding is compatible with IEA's own medium-term coal market report and our flagship publication, World Energy Outlook. Secondly, even if Chinese coal consumption has already peaked, it won't decline drastically in the foreseeable future. Coal is still expected to be the backbone of China's energy sector for quite some years to come. After a discussion on coal, it is natural to spend some time to touch upon oil and gas development in China. Currently, there is ongoing policy debate on oil and gas sector reform in China. I'd like to go through the list one by one. According to my understanding, the deregulation of crude oil license is happening in China now. And the NDRC is continuously deregulating pricing of oil and natural gas. But this is a very slow process with more additional reform to come. China has already established the oil and gas trading platform in Shanghai. However, because of the slow progress on third-party accessible pipeline infrastructure and the difficulties in opening upstream oil and gas sector to private and international investors, whether trading platforms in Shanghai or other parts of the country could effectively reflect demand-supply balance in China is still a big question mark. Take shale gas development in China as an example. Though China has abundant shale gas resource endowment, national production only reached 4.37 BCM in 2015, which means that China's national energy company didn't meet China's shale gas development target in the 12th five-year plan, which is 5 BCM in 2015. In April 2015, IEA and the National Energy Administration jointly organized the third IEA Unconventional Gas Forum in Chengdu. We identified many underground and above-ground barriers for shale gas development in China. The take-home message is that a comprehensive oil and gas sector reform is a prerequisite to tap full potential of natural gas development in China. Another wild card in the Chinese energy sector is nuclear development. Before the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear crisis in 2011, China's operational nuclear capacity was only 10.8 gigawatt. Nevertheless, the nuclear target in 2020 was any number ranging from 70 gigawatt to more than 100 gigawatt before 2011. However, after Fukushima, the Chinese government became much more cautious regarding nuclear development. The most recent government plan for 2020 is only 58 gigawatts. Looking beyond 2020, the Chinese nuclear industry is expected to face post-Fukushima political reality, higher safety standards, technological uncertainties in terms of competition among AP1400 and Chinese indigenous Huanong, less supportive attitude of the general public, rapid development of renewable and overcapacity of coal-fired power plants. From 2014 to 2020, world renewable cumulative capacity addition is expected to rise by 40%. That is more than 700 gigawatt, equivalent to more than twice Japan's current power installed capacity. China alone is responsible for almost 40% of global renewable capacity addition. Fast-growing power demand, diversification needs, and local pollution concern strongly boost renewable development in China and to some extent in India and other emerging economies. Nevertheless, overcapacity of coal-fired power plants has become a particular policy concern in China. During China's ongoing anti-corruption campaign, the central government delegated many responsibilities to the local government. However, to stimulate local economic growth, many provinces approved construction of too many coal-fired power plants in an unprecedented scale. As a result, coal-fired power plants only run slightly over 4,000 hours per year in China. If such a problem cannot be resolved as soon as possible, there will be no room to further develop either renewable or nuclear in China in the future. Given the magnitude of energy and environmental challenges in China, the Chinese government increasingly realized that China is not an energy island, and President Xi Jinping publicly called for international energy cooperation together with four energy revolutions. This table details China's engagement in global energy governance. Before 1978, China had basically no engagement with the international community on energy-related issue. China started the engagement process in 1983 by joining the World Energy Council. Over the years, China became more and more active and influential. The activation of association with the International Energy Agency in 2015 is such a good example. There are many reasons behind China's change of attitude. I'd like to emphasize one particular issue. As the energy world becomes increasingly interconnected with each other, it is difficult for few players to resolve their own energy challenges alone. That explains why multilateral organizations such as the International Energy Agency has a very important role to play in global energy governance. To conclude my presentation, I will only talk about three take-home messages listed in this slide, as it's relatively easy to read the rest on the screen. First, air pollution, together with climate change, has become the most important energy policy drivers in China. Second, comprehensive energy sector reform is the prerequisite to realize the full potential of natural gas utilization and renewable development in China. And the Chinese government should unfold the reform in a timely fashion. Otherwise, the window of opportunity for reform may close quickly. Finally, recent progress between China and the IEA has laid a solid foundation for China's engagement in global energy governance. But the future of bilateral relationship depends on efforts at both the IEA and the Chinese side. This concludes my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention. I look forward to our discussion. Thank you very much.